Well, thanks for the talk. Let's just open the discussion. Are there any questions? Go on, speaker. Yes.
May I start with the last slide? I didn't fully understand. So you have only parts of text. So you didn't take full text for one row, but one text is split up into different parts. And that's why, for example, you must have 60 this is at the top and then at the bottom again.
Indeed, yes. As Mike said, we chunked the text into morsels that were 1,000 words.
Yeah, and that's...
So it can happen that they are clustered.
And is that the full corpus?
This is not the full corpus. This is the network is trained on the undisputed text, and these are passages of text that have been disputed. So in the end, it takes into consideration the full corpus. Oh, by the way, when we meant with something that probably I forgot to say, we took only the speeches. For a couple of our authors, Isocrates and Demosthenes, there are also a few letters that are translated, what are traditionally called, belonging to the genre of letters, that are, we skip them, even if they are very interested in, for authorship problems, we just kept the speeches. But yeah, the complete, the full letter, existing digitized texts of these authors that we could, they are hands-on.
There's a couple of considerations. You can't assume that the text is written by one author, especially in medieval times. This is a situation where you can see a text fall apart in different parts. And it is important to allow that text can be clustered in different clusters. Mm-hmm. One problem here is that, so we used 1,000 word samples to make it difficult. Mm-hmm. So what we will do in the final report is of course also produce plots that use larger samples where the results might be slightly different. Okay. So we've looked into this, they're not very different, but you see differences there. Actually this plot, you can read it pretty literally. So we have rows for every disputed text. Then we have these 10 authors, and each cell is colored according to the probability that the author was assigned. So there, for instance, in that very high cluster, you have a very dark value because it was always attributed to Demosthenes and then never to the other authors. And this is really the probability that were assigned to these attributions.
Right.
Well, the first question is, you might have shown it, and by coming in late, I skipped it. How big is the metadata set you provide for the data that you're analyzing? How complex is, the process of working up the data into an analyzable state?
It's super easy. You did it.
Yes. One thing that's important, we worked with this to digitize by Perseus, and we did just a couple of pre-processing things. But in terms of metadata, I think we only use the order, the name of the order. But in terms of text,
talking about labels, so I've worked with labels.
Well, just by title we meant, as you say, something sometimes referred to 58 or 60. So it's basically their traditional number there, the title. So I could substitute the title for them, like funerary oration or on anamnesis for 7, etc. But this is mostly
many labels or only
the 10 labels set. 10 authors, 10 labels.
We did use some pre-processing though, this may be worth mentioning. Sometimes the authors, the orators quote something, either a literary text, for example one of them, like Lycurgus, was only one oration survived to our days. It's pretty fond of citations from literary texts. Or most of the time, especially for court speeches, they just call the orators call for laws to be read by the clerks and the tribunal, or testimonies to be read, and most of the time these are not preserved. So in the manuscript we just read law or a placeholder word like law or witness, Sometimes the laws are preserved, and okay, their authenticity is disputed. We skipped that. It was very, very easy because it's marked. These parts are marked. Both the citations and the placeholders or the laws are marked in the test with the TEI compliant tags in Burrows, so we could just leave that out and keep the rest. But that's the only pre-processing that we did.
Can I have a question, Anna?
Yes,
sir.
I have another question.
I have two questions. One is regarding stylometry. So, how do you account for changes in style by one author? So, say you have a corpus of one author that spans 40 years. Can you identify that author, whether he's writing in his 20s or his 60s? Does something change?
Yeah, there's quite a bit of interesting studies. A classical example is Henry James, and David Hoover has been doing a lot of research. It's actually fascinating. He can actually show words that he uses increasingly or decreasingly. But the idea is, of course, that your algorithm learns to generalize over these instances if you have a good algorithm. But it is an issue because people can be active for many decades.
But that is based on functional zombie.
Sorry?
Would those studies be based on your function words?
It depends. So Hoover's study also shows content words, but also function words that apparently change. Also, the fact that Henry James started using a typewriter seems to have affected his style, which is a very material something, but it does seem to have a surprising effect. Yeah.
Okay. And have you ever mixed stylometric methods or algorithms with text views?
We can talk about that later.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm working. And yesterday I submitted a project proposal specifically about that issue. Because now we always say these citations, that's Femco, they're not from the author. Mm-hmm. So we should remove them if you want to have a pure text.
Mm-hmm.
And here we do the opposite and we say we only take the citations. And we see whether we can still do stylometry. Because you would think that people, you only borrow something if you like it, right? So it tells something about yourself. I think also, which laws do you cite might be something very insightful for an author.
Yeah.
I'm trying. Maybe it's really just in order to better understand this the deep learning issue. When you look inside of the box in regular stylometry, what you find is features and their probability. Where are the other layers? Like, do you have an option to open the box and see the what would be the features in one of the other layers?
Something that is highly debated right now, because people have started to apply deep learning to language too. So what you would expect is that you would, for instance, if you present the text as a series of characters, then the first layer you detect morphemes, then words, then syntax, and then discourse. I don't know of a single study that actually demonstrates that, but that is what you would expect. And there are indeed ways to look into that. Yeah. So I think that's a hot topic right now. Somebody should do it. Perhaps we should. Because yeah. you might have this very clear hypothesis of what the network is learning. There's not a lot of studies going into visualizing what is being learned for language. So for computer vision, this is very easy because you get the pretty pictures. For language, this is more difficult.
Why not?
Yeah, so again, a simple question for the neuronal network. How do I have to picture it for myself to implement that? Is what you show a graphic, the usual graphics for neural networks, and behind that is just a more complex line of code, an algorithm?
I can show it to
you. How do you implement that really?
There's many libraries who actually...
Yeah, I know. But how much did you have to change that, or could you just pick one?
Okay, so let me show you what the code looks like. It's really easy. So this could be a very simple network. You simply add layers. It's very simple code, where you take them out. Say, I don't want this one. You can just do it like that. So nowadays there are beautiful code libraries that allow you to do this very simply. You simply stack them as you would stack them when you draw them.
Yeah.
That's really, it's become very easy.
Can you give the names? Couple?
The libraries? So one that I like very much is the Piano. Which is developed by a group in Montreal. But that's kind of hard to use. And a library that I like very much is Chaos, which is a very user-friendly interface, you could say. So Google also created their own deep learning library, which is called TensorFlow. And it was kind of hot on Twitter for a while. So you see that a lot of, so I didn't mention this, but a lot of companies are really investing a lot in this technology and actually recruiting quite aggressively. So if you know how to yield deep learning, it's actually kind of easy to get rich nowadays. So coding it isn't very difficult.
Already cases where people suspected that people were writing speeches against themselves or writing both points of view in the same discussion?
Yes, that's an interesting question. Well, not quite like the case of against Demosthenes 58, but there is another interesting case, because already in the antiquity somebody noticed how striking it was that from the same litigation, not exactly the same case, but the same litigation, two different orations, Demosthenes 45 and Demosthenes 36, are preserved today, that deal with the two opposite point of view. they were Demosthenes, but actually, if we assume the traditional authorship by Demosthenes, Demosthenes is one point writing a violent speech against the guy named Apollodorus in defense of the accused person, and then he changes sides, and in 45 he takes the part of Apollodorus. So people have either thought that Demosthenes was very opportunistic in changing sides as it was fitting his own agenda, or maybe since there are question kind of complicated with the relations between the corpus of Demosthenes and the world and this peculiar character named Apollodorus, but let's leave that out. Or the point is that something that was written by Apollodorus ended up, which wouldn't be surprising because other orations did written by Apollodorus ended up in Demosthenes' corpus. And so the case with Demosthenes 45 is the same. So an oration written by Apollodorus that ended in the corpus of Demosthenes. Or if we defend the traditional authorship, so Demosthenes wrote both speeches, we got the same, not exactly the same case, but two cases related to the same dispute, where Demosthenes first wrote a speech for one of the parts, and then years later took up the opposite part. What's interesting is that Demosthenes 45 is somewhere up there. So this, our own stylistic analysis would support, the network would support traditional attribution. We'll say the Demosthenes 45 is by Demosthenes. Yeah?
Just regarding this example, do we know that there is a difference in time? I mean,
yes, we do.
Okay.
Chronologically, yes, we do. Not much, but yeah.
So it's not like an exercise in law and contract.
At the same time, okay, kind of complicated matter, but there are a few orations that were pronounced by these Apollodorus who ended up being in the Demosthenes corpus, and they are stylistically very different from the Demosthenes. So the hypothesis on which almost all scholars would agree today is that they were written by these Apollodorus, and they ended up, for some historical reasons, as being attributed to the Demosthenes, so they ended up in the Demosthenes corpus. There are some controversial cases like this Demosthenes 45, but at the same time, people that were investigating this one, this controversial case, 1945, said, well, this oration doesn't seem to be stylistically too different from the Muslims. So it was not such a clear-cut case in terms of, I don't know, of human readable stylistic traits. Our analysis would seem to support this. This looks like a perfectly demostenic 45, looks like a perfectly demostenic oration.
So, and you said that for court cases you often had ghostwriters, and maybe you said this and I just didn't get it. So do you have the hypothesis that the orators wrote the speeches themselves? Or are you secretly actually clustering writers rather than that you just conveniently name by some orator names?
Well, for the Demosthenes, for example, it's an interesting case because whereas for other authors that were entirely hired hands, so speeches that were just hired. For the Muslims, we got a pretty decent corpus of autobiographical orations. So orations that it's absolutely positive that they were written because the Muslims wanted them written. So they clearly, historically, had the mark of the Muslims. He began his career when he was 18 because he needed to get back his inheritance because the tutors that were appointed to him by his father simply stole everything that they could. So he learned how to do this by going to the best, probably what was the best, orators for inheritance dispute. He won big time and he established his fame. Then he began a career of a respected politician later on, who ended up being one of the most leading political figures in Athens, and produced some of the speeches that ranked pretty high in the sequence in the corpus. A very famous and very passionate political speech that defended his own personal agenda. So that in case of Demosthenes, for example, we are perfectly sure that we got texts that belong to his own political and maybe even forensic agenda. In that case, we are not putting labels, convenient clustering things that are traditionally labeled. In this case, we clearly see the mark. Lysias is a more complicated question, but he was a very famous speechwriter and very respected, so that's put it often later, for example. Respected orator, outstanding speechwriter. Very famous one, and still his reputation is very high today. If you look at schools, for example, the piece is very much better. I don't know if this answers your questions.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering about the right side of this table. Mm-hmm. The low probabilities and the low numbers of texts. If I remember correctly, those on the right are those that had a very small corpus to begin with, right? So doesn't it really tell us more about the method than it is actually a result?
That's an interesting question for maybe.
I don't get the question.
I don't like, try.
Is the low probability and the fact that there are
how many texts do we have from
Hipparion as well?
Six, maybe, if I remember right.
Six.
Yes.
So
fragmentary and not very long, because it has to come from.
So maybe the problem is actually in the training data.
Yeah, but that is a big problem that we still have to look into to do something about this class imbalance. Because somebody like Demosthenes is like everywhere, and these other people, it's very hard for classifiers to deal with that, with these minority classes. Mm. So you could say, for instance, Hyperion there, nothing really gets attributed to him, or nothing consistently, because there aren't many texts. But what is interesting is, for instance, this one,
Linarchus. Mm-hmm. We don't have that many for him either, right?
Yeah.
the heat does attract quite a bit of checks.
Yeah. Also, actually, antiphon acids too.
Yeah. Mm. So it is an issue, but it's also interesting if you get the opposite result.
Yeah. Right.
But sure, the algorithm isn't perfect, so in the end, we only reached 86% accuracy. So that means that only out of 100 attributions, 86 were correct.
Mm-hmm.
So that's quite a high error margin that you have to account for in this plot.
Yeah.
Question there?
Yes, does this method just compare those disputed words to those 10 authors, or can it also build its own clusters for maybe like a author that people thought was similar to Demosthenes but isn't? So can it build like a new author?
Yeah. So that's related to a major issue. So this is actually how authorship attribution was done in the past decades, but since a couple of years, people make a difference between authorship attribution and authorship verification. It's a very interesting difference, because here, this is like a police lineup, right? You have a witness and it has to identify an author, and you can be sure that the author is in the 10 candidates. At least that is the case in a police lineup. Right? Here, of course, we attribute, but we don't give the algorithm the chance to say none of the above. So I don't find the author. And that's actually what you do in authorship verification. There, you simply have two texts, and you ask the algorithm, were they by the same author or not? And that is something that you can do also for two texts by authors that you've never seen before, for instance. So there are techniques to do that nowadays, and we haven't done that. We've tried, but it's also a very difficult problem. Because in a way, it's the holy grail in stylometry. If you can solve that issue, it's like you would take stylometry to the level of fingerprint identification. So if an algorithm gets two fingerprints, the algorithm can say whether it's the same person or not, even if it hasn't seen those two individuals before. And that's something that right now in stylometry, you can't really do yet. No. Does that answer your question?
Yes, so it doesn't naturally form clusters of similar.
No. Yeah. You could do that, and perhaps we should look into that. But that would be an option, instead of steering the algorithm towards a certain classification, just do clustering and see what would happen.
But the Demosthenes 58 seems to be one of these cases where, you know, if it's not attributed in high probability to any of the authors.
Come again? Yeah. You mean this one?
It might be.
58.
This one?
No.
58.
No, 58 to this.
Bottom right.
This
yeah.
One?
Yeah.
Doesn't seem to be quite strongly.
That's yeah. Part of Demosthenes 58, yes. These are interesting, right? A line like this one, you see that the probability is distributed over different options.
It's very low for each of the other authors.
More questions?
Well, I think we thank the speakers again.